Znajdujemy się na Wydziale Prawa i Administracji w Poznaniu, gdzie za chwilkę odbędzie się wykład Chroniąc prawa człowieka w dzisiejszej Europie. Zapraszamy.
Michael, we are sure that your lecture and this meeting will provide an important opportunity for in-depth reflection on what is necessary to meet current most acute challenges and make protecting human rights in Europe work. The floor is yours.
Dean, Professor Kedja Dzidek, Professor Piotr Skubiszewski, dear friends, it's a very great honor to be here this afternoon. It's daunting for many reasons. The first daunting quality of the afternoon is that I'm speaking in front of not one, but two of my former bosses. I have at different points in my life worked both for Dzidek and for Roman Wieryszewski. More seriously, it is always daunting for somebody who works in the field of human rights to come to Poland. The history and the people of your country have taught us so very much about the values that underpin European identity. And I have a sense that I must in some manner do honor to, do justice to that proud legacy in my remarks today. Let me begin by quoting a Pole who spent his life in the service of freedom and who remembered a time when humanity appeared to have plumbed the depths of degradation. Władysław Bartoszewski said in an address to the United Nations Millennium Session of its General Assembly, and I quote, "I remember the joy and the hope with which we greeted the United Nations Charter and the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. They gave me strength when I found myself having to survive the ordeal of years of incarceration in communist jails." Earlier still, the great Polish jurist Raphael Lemkin contributed to the shaping of international human rights law when he conceptualized the crime of genocide. The Genocide Convention will forever remain his legacy. Kofi Annan described Lemkin as having waged a lifelong campaign for every human being's right to live in dignity, a man whose life work offers an inspiring example of moral engagement. The courage of the leaders and the activists of the solidarity movement have impressed me so greatly since the dark days of martial law. Indeed, I had the great privilege of being one of those people with the task of supporting the late Prime Minister Tadeusz Mazowiecki during his time as the United Nations Special Rapporteur for the former Yugoslavia. I recall Mazowiecki's humanity and his heartfelt wish to protect those caught up in conflict. Above all, I recall his integrity, his moral clarity, and his determination. There are many other great Poles whom I might mention, including, of course, Professor Krzysztof Skubiszewski, whom we honor today in the form of this lecture. But for now, suffice it to acknowledge the array of Polish human rights champions, from poets to a pope, from shipyard workers to secretaries of state. We are all in their debt. Dear friends, just now I referred to the welcome given in 1948 to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And it is always well worth your while to revisit the content of the Declaration. Its first article, Article 1, remains as thrilling and as challenging as ever, with its extraordinary statement, "All human beings are born free and equal in dignity and in rights." The story since 1948 is also a special one, with the development of a more or less comprehensive corpus of rights recognized in international law and a framework, albeit an imperfect one, for their international oversight. And these global achievements were paralleled, of course, and even further developed at the regional level. Here in Europe, we slowly elaborated the most sophisticated of all the international human rights legal frameworks. And this was further strengthened by the embrace by the European Union of strong human rights commitments, including in the form of the European Charter of Fundamental Rights. The Charter of Fundamental Rights, the drafting of which drew directly from the Universal Declaration, does not meddle in countries' internal affairs. It simply lays out the inalienable rights of persons living in a country of the European Union. These are rights that everyone is glad to have for themselves and for their families, although some of us are less generous at the thought of them being applied to others. But as not only the Charter, but also national constitutional law makes clear, all people are equal before the law. There is not and cannot be a hierarchy of rights holders. Each individual in the European Union has a claim to the rights of the Charter and can invoke these rights before local courts wherever EU law applies. In this sense, the Charter and EU law in general are instruments of empowerment of people. And so then, we have in the European Union an impressive human rights framework which coexists, does not compete with the constitutional traditions and institutions of its member states. It also, of course, draws on the European Convention of Human Rights, to which all EU member states are party. Respect for this framework and everything that it entails is a condition for membership of the European Union. It is the primary role of the agency that I lead, the European Union Agency for Fundamental Rights, to assist the EU and its member states to uphold their fundamental rights commitments. In so doing, we have a unique mandate, the only regional body of its kind in the world. Operating independently of the EU institutions, we deliver evidence-based advice and analysis to our law and policy makers. We also play an important role in supporting civil society and promoting awareness of and respect for rights across the EU member states. In our work at the national level, we are well aware of how human and fundamental rights commitments must be applied in acknowledgement of and respect for the diversity of national identities. In fact, the Treaty of the European Union stipulates that the EU must, and I quote, respect the national identities of its member states, unquote. In this context, it is my view that the Union provides an additional source of identity to be proud of, just as we are so very proud of our own country and the identity that that gives to us. Colleagues and friends, there is no country or continent, however great its legacy, that can afford to rest on its laurels. It was in 1998 that another great Pole, Pope John Paul II, said, "It is not enough to possess freedom. It must be constantly achieved and recreated. It can be used for good or for ill." His words can be transposed directly to the context of the global and the European human rights protection systems. Across the globe right now, human rights are in contention. In too many countries, the rights themselves and the systems that uphold them are questioned, challenged, ignored, undermined. Sometimes it seems that human rights serves as a proxy battleground for political or ideological disputes. Respect for rights is compromised by patterns of myth-making. One such myth being that rights are only for some people, which of course overlooks the foundational principle that rights are not just for one minority or even many minorities. Human rights are for everyone. We might well then ask, are we facing a crisis of human rights today? Now, it'll take me a little while before I answer that question, and I would ask you to bear with me. Here in Europe, we are definitely seeing increasing intolerance, illustrated by rising patterns of hate crime and hate speech, particularly online. We are also seeing a lack of solidarity. This is illustrated by the fact that EU member states are failing to offer meaningful support to Italy and Greece in responding to the needs of tens of thousands of migrants. Within countries, this lack of solidarity can be observed in the acceptance of ever-increasing levels of inequality. Perhaps of greatest concern, though, is that we are seeing a growing tendency to question the very basics of the human rights framework. Allow me now to go into a little more detail on some of these current developments. First, discrimination and hatred. A society can only flourish when all its members have the same opportunities and enjoy the same rights, from education and career development through to freedom of conscience and freedom of religion. Although we have made great strides in combating racism, xenophobia, hate crime, both legally and institutionally, we are seeing increasingly open and direct demonstrations of intolerance. The patterns of hate speech and crime are to be found across the European Union. The incidence of attacks is on the rise. Numerous groups are targeted. These include Jews and Roma. They also increasingly include foreigners, especially people who may look or dress differently. People perceived to be Muslim are often the target. We at the Fundamental Rights Agency have been closely following these developments over the past year, particularly in the context of the migrant crisis. And each month, we publish an account of the situation in 14 EU member states, including Poland. The story, including here, is sobering and disturbing. And in that regard, let me applaud the initiative of the Conference of Rectors of the Academic Schools of Poland, who on the 25th of November last issued a powerful statement repudiating violence against foreigners and calling for strong, timely, sustained action on the part of the authorities. Beyond identifying attacks, another important measure of whether the rights of a particular community are adequately protected is the level of fear among its members. Surveys carried out by my agency show that this level of fear is high in very many communities, including minority communities, across Europe today. And this matters because fear drains people's strength. It prevents them from living their lives openly, living them as each of us has the right to do. And so hate crime does not just affect one individual targeted victim, it does lasting damage to entire societies. Unacceptably, we see much evidence of such damage done in those targeted communities that have been wounded by hate crime and discrimination. Take, for example, the Roma. 62% of Roma across Europe, in a survey by the agency, said that they have been discriminated against because of their ethnic background in the recent past. 62%. And here again, as I've already said, we must never forget that racism does not just affect the targeted community. Rather, it affects and diminishes all of us. Our societies are made up of everyone within them. And intolerance, whether racial or of any other kind, has the potential, like a cancer, to destroy our society from the inside. To foster cohesive societies based on mutual respect, it is vital that everyone with a public voice is fully aware of his, her, our responsibility not to incite hatred. And in a recent study of the Fundamental Rights Agency, in which we interviewed 200 experts on a theme, we were told by one victim support service, which happened to be here in Poland, the following, and I quote, "It is extremely important for public figures, and here I'm mostly talking about people in power, to clearly, unambiguously, and publicly talk about the topic of hate crime, to unequivocally express disapproval and criticism. This message has to reach the general population of our country." Now, these are not my words, they're the words of a Polish specialist, and by the very nature of those words, has something critical to say about this society. But let's not just call on the responsibility of politicians. They are not the only public figures. Indeed, in the digital age, we can all take on the role of a public figure through the writing of blogs, the issuing of tweets, the posting of material online. And so we have to refer back the public role to each and all of us. And we have to acknowledge that in the context of the digital media, we see increasingly intolerant discourse, often in the form of incitement to discrimination, hatred, or violence. The growing reliance on the internet as the main source of information enables unverified statements to go viral almost instantly, making them extremely difficult to challenge. At the same time, the internet facilitates the development of what we can call information bubbles, in which people only receive information that coincides with their own prejudices, or at least their own opinions. This then, in turn, threatens to turn public debate into blocks of contradicting views in which rational arguments are ignored. My second concern has to do with freedom of speech. I've just spoken of criminal speech, which must be fought decisively. At the same time, however, I would like to make clear that I absolutely oppose the muzzling of freedom of expression. A free and pluralistic media plays an essential role in ensuring that our societies are based on democracy, human rights, and the rule of law, the values upon which the European Union is founded. This means that journalists, publishers, editors, bloggers must be able to carry out their tasks without fear of intervention or reprisal. A study by the Fundamental Rights Agency published just 2 months ago shows that ensuring the safety of those working in journalism, journalism in the broadest sense, is or should be a matter of very serious concern for all EU member states. State and non-state actors alike were found by our study to be exerting unacceptable levels of direct and indirect pressure on journalists and media outlets. For example, state authorities sometimes justify surveillance of journalists on grounds of national security. This makes it more difficult for journalists to maintain confidential sources, an element of journalism that is critical to its quality. In one case that we cite in the study I've just mentioned, in the case of a pre-trial investigation in one EU member state, it was revealed that the Secret Services had been authorized by a more or less untrained district court judge to wiretap 17 journalists in order to discover the source of a leaked government report that did not have national security implications. And that then brings me, thirdly, to more generally issues of security concerns. At the EU and national levels, we need to discuss ways of increasing our capacity to combat terrorism and radicalization while remaining true to the rule of law, and to our human and fundamental rights commitments. In the modifications to intelligence and surveillance legislation that were undertaken by very many EU member states during 2015, we saw the perennial challenge of delivering national security in a manner that is respectful of rights, and especially that the inevitable infringement on rights complies with the non-negotiable principles of legality, necessity, and proportionality. It helps, indeed, when lawmakers recall that a purpose of security policy in a modern state governed by rule of law is to create a space for the enjoyment, for the realization of human rights. Ensuring the safety of everyone in the European Union is undoubtedly of critical importance. However, security must never be invoked as an excuse for the repression of democratic freedoms. Neither is it a zero-sum game between different groups, whereby the safety of one community can only be achieved at the expense of another community. Security measures can only work if they're respectful of human rights and work with and not against all the communities that make up European societies. Dear colleagues, human rights are often regarded as abstract concepts. But as my remarks to you have shown, I hope, the threats to these rights in Europe are not at all abstract. They are very specific and concrete. In the same way, their protection demands on action that is analogously prosaic, real, and applied. And if you allow, I will list some of those essential elements of effective human rights protection for Poland as for any other European Union member state. First and foremost is the importance of the rule of law. To quote Niels Muzhniks, the Council of Europe Commissioner for Human Rights, there can be no real human rights protection without mechanisms guaranteeing the rule of law, in particular by ensuring checks and balances among the different state powers. End of quote. And nonetheless, notwithstanding what Muzhnik says, we are seeing an increasing challenge to the rule of law in many places around the European Union. One crucial aspect of the rule of law is the independence of the judiciary and of the institutions that make up the overall human rights framework. The checks and balances that ensure that no one branch of government becomes overpowerful are a precondition for democracy. And each member state in the European Union can be proud to have a fully fledged democracy, particularly those states that have so recently struggled against and have overcome totalitarian rule. Constitutional courts and ombudsmen have to be seen as vital, as essential to the lifeblood of our states. Such courts and institutions are strengths to be nurtured and not problems to be solved. Constitutional courts are especially crucial in that they are the final arbiters of constitutional matters. Other actors in the political and legal system should have the greatest of respect for the independence that is necessary to fulfill this role. Furthermore, challenges to the independence and impartiality of the judiciary, as well as the undermining of ombudsmen and other such independent institutions, will also lead inevitably to a breakdown in public trust in the fairness and the quality of the justice system. Human rights and the economy are not the subject of my remarks today, but I would add as an aside that governments as well as local authorities must fully understand and take advantage of the fact that a strong judicial system fosters the investment that economies so badly need. From this perspective, respect for the rule of law should be regarded as a key element of sustained economic growth. Business needs to have certainty, needs guarantees of fairness in order to invest. And where these guarantees are either missing or perceived to be missing, frankly, the money will go elsewhere. Also vital for the protection of human rights is a thriving and vibrant civil society. For a number of years now, civil society organizations in the European Union and beyond have reported that the space in which to carry out their work is shrinking. They mention, for instance, a reduction in access to financial resources, burdensome regulation, fewer opportunities to access decision makers. In some places, they tell of violent attacks and of the harassment of human rights defenders. These issues will be the subject of very close attention by the Fundamental Rights Agency in 2017, whereby the protection of civil society will become seen as much an internal as an external concern for the European Union. The third element of the infrastructure we need to have thriving human rights respectful societies is the requirement that we have civil courage. I know it's not easy, but it is nonetheless vital. If you see hatred or discrimination, do not look away. Sometimes it is possible to intervene directly. Sometimes it is a matter of patient perseverance. Whom should I put the victim in touch with? What legislation is contravened by this action? Whom do I turn to if I'm a victim myself? Ask yourself these questions. Don't give up until you get an answer, no matter how partial that answer might be. The state, our states, every state, must be held to account for the human rights obligations to which it has freely committed itself. In this regard, of one thing you can be sure, the EU Agency for Fundamental Rights stands ready to support you. In arguing your case for human rights, make use of our analysis, our solidarity, our data, our advice. Also, make the best possible use of the resources, recommendations, and findings of the United Nations, of the Council of Europe, and of other bodies. I would like to make one last point on the protection of human rights, and that is to learn from history, and learn it well. To quote yet another great Pole, the Nobel Prize-winning poet Czesław Miłosz, forgive the pronunciation, he said, and I quote, "The living owe it to those who no longer can speak to tell their story for them. The living owe it to those who no longer can speak to tell their story for them." Poland's rich and often tragic history gives its people a keen sensitivity to the past. This must be harnessed for the present. School pupils and the general public alike need to receive a nuanced teaching of the past. This knowledge provides an opportunity to reflect on contemporary problems with a greater understanding, thus ensuring that history is used to heal, not to divide. No country is composed entirely of heroes, and to seek to reinterpret history as though this were the case does a disservice to all those who lived and died for their country. Dear colleagues and friends, you've listened to me now for a long time, and you may be surprised that I have made relatively little direct mention of the current circumstances in Poland. Circumstances, frankly, that are receiving so much attention internationally. I took this approach deliberately because I wanted, rather than to reiterate the authoritative commentary, finding and recommendations of the Council of Europe Venice Commission, the Council of Europe Commissioner for Human Rights, the United Nations Human Rights Committee, the European Commission, and others, instead of reiterating those and speaking to those for the nth time, I've rather sought to examine the situation in a broader context. And as I hope I have made clear, there is not one European Union country in which human rights are not at risk. Let me close then by answering the question I posed at the beginning. Do we have a crisis of human rights? No, I don't think we do. What we do have is a major crisis, a crisis of commitment to human rights. Human rights cannot be viewed as an optional extra that can be sacrificed. They are the cornerstone of our identity. Europe will have failed if we fail on this issue, which is so close to the values on which the European Union was founded. We must have the courage of our convictions, the courage to speak out against human rights violations, and the courage to act. With this courage, with energy and with goodwill, we can overcome this crisis to ensure that human rights protection does not become a hollow shell, but remains at the beating heart of our societies. I will leave the final words to Pope John Paul II, who said in an extraordinary address to the United Nations General Assembly in 1979, by the way, address that every one of you should download and reread in 2017, but among the many wonderful quotes I could choose from his address on that day, let me leave you with these words. Although each person lives in a particular concrete social and historical context, every human being is endowed with a dignity that must never be lessened, impaired, or destroyed, but instead must be respected and safeguarded. Friends, it is our challenge as individuals and societies to honor those lofty words. I thank you.